Good, alhamdulillah. MashaAllah. Barakallah. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah wa kafa wa salamun ala ibadihi alladhina astafa la siyama al-Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallama tasliman kathira. All praise be to Allah alone, all praise man who seek His help. Whomsoever Allah guides is a truly guided one, and whomsoever Allah leads astray, no one can show him guidance. May the peace and blessings be upon Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa ba'd, did you guys figure out the topic and what it means? Who did?
Yeah.
Huh. Be rich?
Or die trying?
Or die trying. Die trying what?
Get rich.
Get rich. Can you imagine somebody just living to get rich? And they keep trying until they die. This is basically the ultimate goal of the vast majority of people. We're born to eat, drink, and satisfy their desires by every and any possible means, and that's it. There is no much difference between such human beings and cattle. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, أُولَٰئِكَ كَالْأَنْعَامِ بَلْ هُمْ أَضَلُ. Definitely, we were created for a much greater reason and purpose. But in fact, there is a beautiful, short and brief chapter of the Quran that covers the whole subject in a few ayat, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ألهاكم التكاثر حتى زرتم المقابر كلا سوف تعلمون ثم كلا سوف تعلمون كلا لو تعلمون علم اليقين لترون الجحيم ثم لترونها عين اليقين ثم لتسألن يومئذ عن النعيم. As I told you, the chapter is short but great. التكاثر means rivalry or competition. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ألهاكم التكاثر. Most certainly, this kind of competition, the worldly competition to pile up wealth and get richer and richer, has kept you busy. Kept you busy from the main purpose which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created you for. And in fact, this is absolutely true. Then, hatta zurtumul maqab, you're going to keep busy piling up wealth, keep busy getting sucked in this competition till the end. حتى زرتم المقام. A companion by the name Abdullah ibn Shakir, may Allah be pleased with him, said, I once entered upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he was reciting this surah, أَلْهَاكُمُ التَّكَاثُرُ. Then he said, يَقُولُ إِبْنُ آدَمَ مَا لِي مَا لِي. He elaborated on the meaning of أَلْهَاكُمُ التَّكَاثُرُ, how the competition kept many people busy and diverted them from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created them for, and the ultimate goal of life. So he said, son of Adam will keep saying, my wealth, my wealth. We hear this all day long, my car, my clothes, my business, my flat, my positions, my bank account, my. وَهَلَّكَ مِنْ مَالِكَ. Then the Prophet ﷺ has presented this, the third question, he said, وَهَلَّكَ مِنْ مَالِكَ إِلَّا مَا أَكَلْتَ فَأَفْنَيْتَ أَوْ لَبِسْتَ فَأَبْلَيْتَ أَوْ تَصَدَّقْتَ فَأَبْقَيْتَ وَمَا سِوَى ذَلِكَ فَسَائِرٌ وَتَارِكُهُ لِغَيْرِكَ. What does it mean? Do you really own or possess anything of this wealth which you think that it is used other than what you have already eaten, consumed, and excreted its waste? And I'll explain the meaning of this part. Or you wear until you tear, or whatever you give in a charity, that is your saving account. The Prophet ﷺ said, do not be deceived by your possessions, because in fact, you do not possess what it seems to be yours. Your actual position is what you benefit out of it is not what you save, and it is sitting there for years. And it keeps accumulating and increasing and growing bigger and bigger and bigger. Yours is what you consume, what you benefit out of it, to the extent that you say, what you eat, ما أكلت فأفنيت. So if there is some food which is all prepared for you, this food is not yours, not unless if you eat it fully. Not only that, you eat it, you digest it, then you excrete the waste. Before that, it's not yours. One day, my grandfather was sitting, was visiting a village, and they were talking about the same subject. And somebody said, well, if the bite is in my mouth, no one can take it out of me, no matter what happens. So my grandfather argued with him and said, no, it can be in your mouth, but it's not yours. And this is an Arabic phrase in the cigar. It can be in your mouth, but it still is not yours. He said, how? So while they were sitting, they have ducks and chicken, rabbits, and you know, domestic animals. Nobody in the farms, they manually feed the ducks the grains in order to get bigger and bigger. So anyway, one of those ducks were overfed. So it overthrew the grains, the corn seeds, on the floor. So the rest of the chicken ran towards it and they picked the corn seeds and they ate it. He says, subhanAllah, it was not only in the mouth, rather it was already in the stomach. But it is not yours. I reflected on this a great deal. Many times, one day, I was into name brands, Polo, Tommy Hilfiger, and these, you know, I was after the big time. With the perfumes, clothes, fashions, and so on. In America, of course. So when I opened my closet and I looked at all what I have and I say, I wonder, subhanAllah, who's gonna wear this? Definitely, I'm not gonna wear all of that. I'm not gonna wear it until I turn them. That is the second part of the hadith. لَيْسَ لَكَ مِنْ مَالِكَ إِلَّا مَا لَبِسْتَ فَأَبْلَيْتَ. Only what you wear until you tear, so that nobody else would wear it after you because it's already torn apart or worn out. But if it is still can be worn by somebody else, maybe you will lie and you will leave it and it will be given to somebody else. أَوْ تَصَدَّقْتَ فَأَبْقَيْتَ. Nuts, what you eat and execute. What you wear until you tear. Or whatever you give in a charity, and that is your actual saving. فَأَبْقَيْتَ. That is the part which would remain for you. That's why one day the Prophet ﷺ has slaughtered a sheep. And he let Aisha take care of its distribution. When he returned, he asked her about it. She said, Ya Rasulullah, it's all gone except for the shank. That is the body part of the sheep which the Prophet ﷺ used to prefer. She said, it's all gone. Yeah, I distributed it all, except for the shank. He said, no. It has been already saved, all of it, except for the part which we're going to eat. We eat it the next week. But the part which we give it in a charity, that is our actual saving. A very interesting story happened with a Turkish billionaire. This guy heard his story and it's fascinating. I heard it in Hajj a few years back. At the time of his death, he wrote a will of two parts. He said, part one to be opened at the time of my death, and the second after the burial. So when he expired, he left a lot of money, billions of dollars. They followed the instructions. Before even they bury his body, they open the will, the first part. And in this part, there's a very strange will. Very weird request. He said, whatever happens, make sure that when you wash my body, keep my socks on. Don't take my socks off, please. What is the reason? They have no idea. So they consulted the sheikh. This guy was a Muslim and went to wash his body. He said, no. We have to take the socks off. We have to wash his body. But that was his wish. We don't care. If any person made a wasiyah against the Sharia, it's neglected. So he handed him his socks off. Then they washed his body. They wrapped him in the shroud, in the coffin. They buried him. And now they were very anxiously waiting to open the second part of the wasiyyah, how the tarikah inheritance would be divided. And they said, didn't I tell you, you're not going to leave anything for me, not even my socks, not even my dirty socks. He wanted to make a point, which is nobody takes nothing with them, not even their dirty socks, not even their other clothes. You know, when my beloved children come to bury me and they see I'm wearing a nice ring, are they going to say, keep it for him? No, because it's not for him, rather it will be for the Lord. It will be for the earth. Take it off. The glasses, the watch, and everything. مِنْهَا خَلَقَنَاكُمْ وَفِيهَا مُعِيدُكُمْ وَمِنْهَا نُخْرِجُكُمْ تَارَةً أُخْرَى. So this is one part which we wanted to begin with, to finalize with you and emphasize a very important fact, which is no matter how rich you get, no matter how much you pile up of wealth, yours is what you already use by either eating, digesting, the excreting the waste, or wearing until you tear, or what you save in investment with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, such as in a church. Besides that, literally, it isn't yours, is it? Can you guarantee that you're going to look after your money until tomorrow? Can anyone on earth make sure that he's going to stay till tomorrow to look after his wealth? Can anyone guarantee that his wealth will stay still till tomorrow? No, never. This is the thing which makes every human being so scared and worried. The richer you get, the more worried you are, because you are there to guard your wealth. And you are afraid what's going to happen if you leave it. It makes you worry. That's why we need to think smart. Is it really like the American dream? You know the American dream? What is the American dream? Huh? Who knows?
A beautiful wife, a house, and a beautiful car.
Do you think a beautiful wife is even in the dream? No. A house. To buy a house. The word wife does not even fit in the category of the dream. No. I'll tell you why. One day I had an electrician who was fixing the internet in my house. And normally I have some handout materials on Quran to give dawah, and I have to keep the conversation going, you know. So I asked him about his family and how many kids do you have? He said, 3. And the mother said, no, actually we're not married. We're just living together. I said, man, if you're really having kids together, why don't you get married? I mean, you've been living together for 7, 10 years or whatever. You have already 3 children. Why don't you get married? Talking about the wife. You know what he's saying? He said, no man, I bought the house on my own. It's not my house. It's a lot easier to get rid of her whenever I want to. I can just kick her out. There's no security. Security is only in the bank balance, in the position. And wallahi, this incident happened to me. I had an oncologist who came and he consulted me. He said that I want to divorce my wife. I said, why? I've seen his wife, I've seen his children, 2 beautiful kids, a boy and a girl. I said, why? He said, you know, for the past years I've been making, you know, $100,000 or whatever. This year I'm expected to make $1 million. I said, what does this have to do with divorcing your wife, for God's sake? Do you have a problem? Is there a serious problem? I can counsel. He said, no. But you know, I already have 100 grand now. If I divorce her, she will get 50,000. So what? But if I wait until the end of the year, she's going to collect and have million. Yeah. It is a material. أَلْهَاكُمُ التَّكَاثُرُ حَتَّى زُرْتُمُ الْمَقَابِرُ حَتَّى زُرْتُمُ الْمَقَابِرُ. You know what the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said also about this ayah? لَوْ مُعْتِيَ ابْنُ آدَمْ وَادٍ مِنْ ذَهَبْ. If son of Adam, we're talking about generally speaking, of course there are exceptions. If the son of Adam is given a whole valley or a mountain of gold, mountain of gold. How long would it take you to spend it? Forever? يتمنى أن يكون له ثاني. You still wish to have a second one. Why, Sheikh, to secure the future of my kids and the grandkids? You never know. Stock market keeps going up and down. But this is a mountain of gold. Still, you know, some more. And that's why I see people, grown of men, grown of women, do not even know how to read an ayah of the Quran. They say, inshallah, when I retire, I will start learning how to read the Quran. Give me a written guarantee that you're going to live until you retire. And another incident, wallahi, where I've seen some people, I ask them, mashallah, Allah bless you with wealth. And you have more than one house, and you have several cars. Why don't you perform Hajj? You know what did he say to me? I'm waiting for Hajj whenever it comes on Christmas.
Christmas.
I'm waiting for the Hajj to come on Christmas. You know that the lunar calendar versus the Gregorian calendar. So that was several years ago before the Hajj coincided with Christmas. Now it's even past, it's earlier than Christmas now. Why? It says so that I will take my vacation and go for Hajj. So they adjust Allah's demands and fara'id on their own hawa and desire. Once again, it is because of what? Al-ha'u mu'takas. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَلَمْ أُعْطِيَ الثَّانِي. What if Allah fulfilled his wish and has given him a second man? Did Bill Gates quit working? No. Will he? Why? Why? This is a human nature. Keep piling up wealth more and more and more and more. SubhanAllah, one day when you're looking at the Honda Civic and you say, man, that's my dream car. I just want to have a Honda Civic, an automatic, and wheels and so on. Once you get the traffic light, when you have somebody driving a BMW next to you, you say, man, this is the kind of life. This is what I always wanted. What happened to your dream? It never stopped at a limit. It doesn't have a roof. It goes way beyond your limits. Your dreams, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam once drew a box on the sand. He illustrated as he normally does, a box on the sand, against the sand. And he said, this box, this square is like your boundaries, your lifespan. Your lifespan. Then he drew an arrow going through that square, going all the way out, like a spear. And said, this is al-amal. Your dreams go beyond your limits, like you're living infinitely. Then he drew cross lines and said, these are al-a'rad. You have endless dreams, infinite amal. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's qadr will come to stop your amal. You have to recognize this. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَلَا يَمْلُوا عَيْنَ مَا آدَمَ إِلَّا طَعَى. If he's given a second, he will wish to have a third. If he's given a third, you can even have more. And nothing would satisfy him, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, would fill his eyes, or his abdomen, his stomach, other than a turab, which is the dirt. Indicating what? When he dies, when he enters the grave, and then we bury him and the dirt will enter his eyes. That is the only thing which will make him realize that you have a beginning and soon you will have an end. You have a beginning and soon you will have an end. As believers, what makes us entirely different than others is the following fact. We live in peace, in comfort, and tranquility. We walk in peace. We try to earn our living. We are very ambitious as well. But we recognize the following fact. That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith, إِنَّ رُوحَ الْقُدُسِ نَفَثَ فِي رُوعِي. روح القدس جبريل عليه السلام نَفَثَ فِي رُوعِي, يعني inspired into me, in my soul. To my soul. He revealed to me the following fact. إِنَّهُ لَن تَمُوتَ نَفْسٌ حتى تستوفي رزقها وأجلها فأجمل الطلب. You know, if we do not discuss anything today, but this hadith it should be more than sufficient. MashaAllah, you're all youth, you are very ambitious, you have a long way to go. But take this hadith, the Prophet said, Allah has revealed to him the following fact. There is not a single soul of a human being, of jinn, of any living creature. You know, the microbes, the virus, every microorganism, even those which we cannot see but via the electronic microscopes, their provision is due upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They also eat and drink, they survive on provision. Who knows about the provision? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he's saying, لَن تَمُوتَ نَفْسٌ, not a single soul will expire before receiving on full two things. رِزْقَهَا وَأَجَلَهَا. It's full provision and it's full lifespan. No one is gonna die missing a single soul drink, or a single bite, or a dollar that he had to earn, or a moment in his or her life. One day somebody was sitting with Prophet Sulaiman, peace be upon him. Sulaiman alayhi salam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him the means of the leadership, and among is that he used to control the wind, he used to control the jinn, he used to speak to the animals, and he used to see the angel of death physically. While he was sitting, one of his friends was sitting in his council meeting, and he was so frightened, and he went to Sulaiman alayhi salam and he begged him, O Prophet of Allah, do me a favor. He said, what? He said, can you order the wind, the speed of the wind, can you order the wind to take me to the farthest place? Sulaiman was in Palestine. He said, why? He said, I see this angel staring at me and he's frightening me. So he ordered the wind to carry this man to India, the other part of the world. Then he had a talk with the angel of death who frightened his guest. He said, what is the matter? He said, why were you staring at him? He said, SubhanAllah, Allah has sent me to take his soul in India. What was he doing here? He said, he did. Well, he asked for it. Don't you think that you can outsmart Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Only executing the blueprint which have been drawn for you before you were even created. إِنَّ اللَّهَ قَدَّرَ الْمَقَادِيرَ. Allah has ordained the decrees of every creature 50,000 years before the creation of the heavens and the earth. That makes us as Muslims feel comfortable and have a peace of mind. If we perceive these meanings and we understand them, if we comprehend them. But those who think that, well, if I work 28 hours a day, I'm gonna earn more. No. You're only making the provision which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has preordained for you. Hadith Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, may Allah be pleased with him. Wallahi, this is amazing. When the Prophet ﷺ spoke about the different stages of embryology in the womb, nutfa, alaqa, mudra, then he says, ثُمَّ يُرْسَلُ إِلَيْهِ الْمَلَكُ, after 4 months, 40, that's 4 months and 10 days, فَيُؤْمَرُ بِأَرْبَعِ كَلِمَاتِ يَنْفُخُ فِيهِ الرُّوحِ وَيُؤْمَرُ بِأَرْبَعِ كَلِمَاتِ. When you're still a hanging morsel of flesh, unformed yet, in the womb of your mother, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send an angel to breathe the soul into this morsel of flesh to be a living human being, and he will write down four commands. Rizqihi wa ajarihi wa amarihi wa shaqiyin aw sa'id. Your provision, every bite that you deserve in this life is written for you. You cannot change it. You cannot skip it. Even if you don't want it, you cannot skip it. وَأَجَلِهِ, and his lifespan. This guy whom we read about in the news in Saudi, a laborer, he fell from the 6th or the 7th floor while he was making the paint of the building. He fell on the concrete. Everybody was scared. He's dead. His head must be smashed and the blood all over. And they were shocked to see the person standing up on foot. He was not hurt the least. Everybody, are you okay? Yeah, I'm fine, are you okay? So he wanted to celebrate, he wanted to buy drinks for everybody. The guy was selling drinks across the street, he was crossing the street to buy the drinks, he got hit by a car. He was not due to die 5 minutes ago, even though he fell from the sixth or the seventh floor on the concrete. But it was not his turn yet. Rather, he was due to die 5 minutes there or by any means, even on bed. We want to have these facts settled in our mind, to calm down, to recognize that we were created for a greater reason, which is, what is the purpose of life?
Worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Typically, this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Surah Al-Dhariyat, وَمَا خَلَقَتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Worship is not only the ritual, the salah, the zakah, and the fasting, but earning our provision is ibadah. Getting married is ibadah. Having an intimate relationship with your spouse is ibadah. You can transfer every worldly activity in your life into an act of worship. When you work in halal and you avoid the haram, you will be rewarded for that. When you recognize that no matter how busy you are, you will never miss a prayer time, then your work has become a ibadah. But when you give precedence to your business meeting, you miss one and two prayers, then you are a loser. Such person is a loser. Such person is a loser. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, إِنَّ الدُّنْيَا حُلْوَةٌ خَضْرَةٌ. The life of this world is sweet, green, glittery, attractive. فَحْذَرُهَا. So beware of it. Avoid its temptations, and avoid the temptations of women. The fitna of Bani Israel were in women, and the fitna of this ummah as the Prophet ﷺ will be in wealth, in material, in money. When the companions were very poor and they heard that the Prophet ﷺ received some gifts, so they showed up and they lined up before him at Fajr because he knew that Abu Ubaid ibn al-Jarrah wrote some gifts. He said, I know what you hear. Wallahi ma al-faqr akhsha alaykum. I'm not afraid for you, poverty. No, rather, what I'm afraid for you is al-dunya an tuftaha alaykum fatanafasuha kama tanafasuha fatuhlikakum kama ahlakakum. I'm afraid that Allah will give you the dunya in abundance, to the extent that it will distract your attention from the main purpose which you were created for. And eventually it will destroy you as it did destroy people before you. Isa ibn Maryam alayhi salam, very interesting athar. He once was traveling, and one of the children of Israel saw him traveling and said, "Why are you up?" He said, "I'm heading this way." He said, "Can I join me?" He said, "Sure." Isa alayhi salam had raghif, one loaf of bread. And this guy had two. So he put them together. So that whenever it's, you know, eating time, they would eat together. Isa alayhi salam rested somewhere and he started praying. This guy, in his mind, said, well, he only have one loaf of bread and I have two. So if we eat, he may share me in one of my bread. So hardly he ate one. So that it would be even. Isa has one and he has one. And this is one of Bani Israel. So when Isa alayhi salam finished, he said, let's eat. Yeah, sure. He said, what happened to the third loaf of bread? He said, there was no third. He said, yes, there was one. He said, no. وَالَّذِي بَعَثَكَ بِالْحَقِّ. There were only two. He said, okay. صدق الله وكذبت عيناه. Allah, because you said wallahi, then you are telling the truth and I belied my eyes. They traveled and they crossed the river. So Isa alayhi salam said bismillah and he took his hand and they walked on the surface of water. They walked on the water. The Israeli was going crazy. How did you know that? He said, I asked you by the one who showed you this sign, who ate the third loaf of bread. He said, wallahi, I told you there were only two. He said, okay, they proceeded on. And they wanted to eat, so Isa alayhi salam hunted a deer. Then they broiled it, they cooked it, and they ate it. And there's only the bones. So Isa alayhi salam said to the bones to be reassembled by the leave of Allah. And he ordered it to come back to life. It was alive again. And it took off. Israeli couldn't take it. He said, how did you know that? He said, I asked you by the one who showed you this ayah, who ate the third loaf of bread. He said, wallahi, there were only two. Why can't you believe me? He said, okay. They traveled. They came across three piles of gold. Isa alayhi salam took him to three piles of gold. The guy's eyes grew wide and said, wow. He said, yeah, this is for me and this is for you. He said, what about the third one? He said, we're going to save it to the one who ate the third loaf of bread. He said, I ate it. I swear I ate it. He said, we're going to take the whole thing. Then he walked on him. He left him alone. He sat next to the gold. He doesn't know what to do with it. He doesn't know how to carry it. Three highway robbers passed by. They caught this guy. Without thinking, they killed him. And they decided to divide the treasure. Each one would take one pile of gold. So they say to one of them, why don't you go buy us some food so that we'll be able to carry the gold? He said, I'll be more than happy to do that. When he went to buy the food and get the food, he said, why divide it one thing? Well, I can take it all. So he poisoned the food to poison his friends. He returned and the two have already agreed. Why divide it among three if we can divide it only two? So once he brought the food, they killed him. And they ate the food. So they were poisoned. They died. Isa alayhi salam returned back to see four of them dead and the gold was sitting there the same. Said, this is the dunya. Brothers and sisters, this is a dunya. This is a dunya. You know, in Surah Al-A'raj, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ خُلِقَ هَلُوعًا إِذَا مَسَّهُ الشَّرُّ جَزُوعًا وَإِذَا مَسَّهُ الْخَيْرُ مَنُوعًا. This is the human nature of average mankind. Insan is created very impatient. If adversity ever touches him, he's impatient, he complains, he panics. وَإِذَا مَسَّهُ الْخَيْرُ مَنُوعًا. And if Allah blessed him with wealth, he said, so mine. I made it all because of my intelligence. I worked hard. He should have seen me. I used to walk barefooted. I started it all from the scratch. Where does he remember to say, wallahi, it's all from Allah. It is all because of Allah. It's not because of my intelligence. I'm just a human being. Allah blessed me. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, and I wish somebody can translate this for me and help me out to translate it. Al-mukthiruna humu muqilluna yawm al-qiyamah. Who knows?
The poorest will be.
Al-mukthiruna humu muqilluna yawm al-qiyamah. The one who has more will have less on the day of judgment. Okay, getting closer. What does it mean? يعني إيه? Huh? We spoke about a takasur, competition in piling up wealth and dunya. Now,
who does have more money in life will be less in Yawm al-Qiyamah.
Less in what?
Less in numbers.
In what?
No.
Less in good deeds. Why? Because he's been too busy. I know people, a couple of months ago, I had an American guy who came all the way from America and he wanted to meet us in the shul in Egypt. And I was kind of suspicious because it's weird that somebody is flying all the way from the States to see the shul. Why? He's a very rich person and he said, I was born to work. I used to work 18 hours a week, every day. And I made a lot of wealth until he heard one of the lectures of the shiur about the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and so on. So it changed my life and so on. So I wanted to come and shake hands with you guys and thank you and so on. He said, wallahi, subhanallah, I used to work like a donkey. I was not a human being. I never enjoyed a bit of my life. And now, the whole time I give to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I actually have an increase in my provision. I have an increase in my provision. And I enjoy my life more than before. Behold, brothers and sisters, I don't want anyone to misunderstand me, nor misquote me, or take me wrong and say that the Shaykh is asking us not to be at the dunya, not to think to be rich. No, not at all. Abdul Rahman ibn Awf, radiallahu anhu, he was a multi-millionaire, and he started from the scratch, as you know. Yet he is one of the 10 heaven-bound companions, provided. He said by Allah, if I flip a stone, I will find gold beneath it. Yani, if he, the dirt will turn into gold in his hand. Why? Because of his honesty, because of not transgressing against the time of ibadah, because of giving in charity. That's why the Prophet ﷺ said when he said, Al aktharuna aw al mukthiruna hum al muqilluna yawm al qiyamah, because the day has 24 hours. If you take 18 hours after money, what's left? What's left? You can barely go to sleep for a couple of hours and spend the rest of the time in the bathroom. Is that right? So he said, أَلْمُكْثِرُونَ هُمُ الْأَقَلُّونَ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ will have the least good deeds. They didn't have a chance. إِلَّا except the one whom Allah blessed with many first. فَقَالَ بِهِ هَكَذَا وَهَكَذَا وَهَكَذَا. يعني he was making up for the shortcoming in the now by giving in a charity. By giving in a charity. I was invited by a very wealthy person, mashallah, billionaire before, and he told me a very interesting story that he used to give 10% of his income. And that's why Allah gave him barakah. And no matter what happens to the market, his business will grow and will boom. Until he met a friend of his, and he was proud of himself that he gives 10% and Allah gives him what he said. Alhamdulillah, ever since I started this, Allah gives me, I give 30% of my income. So he felt like an ant compared to an elephant. So he decided that every penny will enter his pocket, or every profit he will make, he will give 1/3 of it. And he tells me, Wallahi, Wallahi, I have the greatest increase ever since I decided so. In fact, this is a guy who's living currently, and mashallah, he's doing this kind of business, and his business is international. And the Prophet ﷺ told us in a hadith, while a man was walking in the desert one day, he heard a sound coming from the cloud. It says, "Irwi hadiqata fulan." Irwi, yani irrigate the garden of such and such, where that was right in the middle of nowhere, in the desert. He said, then all of a sudden I saw the cloud was redirected itself, like it was driven. So I followed the cloud, because it's in the open. Then it stopped somewhere, and it started dropping its rain. So he rushed to see where the water is going. He followed the water, it made like a creek, like a snake, until it reached into a garden right in the middle of the desert. So he entered, he found the water, he entered the garden. This is some hadith, by the way. He entered the garden and he found a man was sitting, and with his spade or his axe, he was redirecting the water here and there to irrigate the hadiqa, the garden, the bustan. He said, Assalamu alaikum, what's your name? So he told me his name. He said, this is the same name which I heard. He said, you heard it where? I heard it in the cloud. What's your matter? What do you do? He said, since you heard my name in the cloud, I gotta tell you. This garden of mine, I made a deal with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every harvest I divided into three. 1/3 I give for myself and family. 1/3 I give in charity, and 1/3 I reinvested in the garden again. And that's why I'm not worried about it. Allah sends me the rain right in the middle of the desert, as you see. There's a beautiful surah, it's called Surah Al-Qalam. You know this surah? Noor al-Qalam wa ma yasturun. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us a beautiful story. The story of Ashabul Jannah. Al-Jannah in the Quran, when we speak about it, basically it's heaven, unless there's an indication that it refers to a garden. Whenever somebody has a garden which is full of greenery, fruits and vegetations, we call it Jannah. Because similar to Jannah, yani. So these guys, their father used to do likewise. Used to divide the harvest of the garden or the bustan into three portions. And every time they harvest the fruits, the one third of the pool is set aside, they come and they collect. The father died. So they said to each other, our father was fool. He used to give to the lazy people, and this is our money. We made it all. We shall give no one an apple out of that. So what to do? The poor will be coming tomorrow to collect their share and so on. Say, no, before sunrise, we better go while it's dark. الْأَقْسَمُ لَيَصْرِمُنَّهَا مُصْبِحِينَ وَلَا يَسْتَثْنُونَ فَطَافَ عَلَيْهَا طَائِفٌ مِّن رَبِّكَ وَهُمْ نَائِمُونَ. They said, we will harvest all. So they come and say, it's gone. There's nothing left for you. فَطَافَ عَلَيْهَا طَائِفٌ مِّن رَبِّكَ وَهُمْ نَائِمُونَ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent something that burned down the whole garden while they were asleep. So when they went in the morning to check it out, to harvest the fruits, there was no garden. They looked at each other and said, "Inna ladhalun." We must have went to the wrong address. This is not our garden. One of them confronted them and said, "No, that is the right address. Rather, you guys went astray because of your greed. Because of your greed. When you do business with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have to recognize the following fact. In math, 1 + 1 = 2. 10 + 10 = 100 + 100 = 1,000 + 1,000, right? It's almost like that. If you ever give a different answer, they will be considered wrong. But this is not the case with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is not the case with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. مثل الذين ينفقون أموالهم في سبيل الله كمثل حبة أنبتت سبع سنوات في كل سنبلة 100 حبة والله يضاعف لمن يشاء. When before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala equals 700. 700 now, provided it is earned lawfully and it is given out with sincerity. He says it's as simple as this. When the farmer sows a seed of a wheat grain or a corn grain, then he waters it. What happens? It produces a stack of corn ears. 7 of them. Each one is carrying 100 grains times 7. That is 700. Who made this one single grain produces 700? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the 700 is not the maximum. Rather, وَاللَّهُ يُضَاعِفُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. He says in Surah An-Nur, and this ayah may suit you very much, وَأَنْكِحُ الْأَيَامَ مِنْكُمْ وَالصَّالِحِينَ مِنْ عِبَادِكُمْ وَإِمَائِكُمْ. Most of the youth keep delaying and postponing their marriage. Why? I'm not ready yet. Why? Why?
Money.
Huh? Have a job. You have a job already. I first have to purchase my own flat. I have to own a flat. I do live in a rental property. I have to feel secure. Okay, you got a flat. What's next?
Car.
And what's next? You keep postponing. Do you think these are the means of establishing a happy married life? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَنْجِحُ الْأَيَامَ وَالصَّالِحِينَ مِنْ عِبَادِكُمْ وَإِمَائِكُمْ أَنْ يَكُونُوا فُقَرَاءَ يُغْنِهِمُ اللَّهُ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ. Even in the poor, Allah promises, because they are getting married for the iffah, for the chastity, instead of hanging around and dating and so on, they get married lawfully. For this reason, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will enrich them out of His bounty. Wait a minute. The rest is the most amazing. يُغْنِهِمُ اللَّهُ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ. Wallahu wasi'un alim, and he did not say insha'Allah. which means it is guaranteed every couple who are getting married to protect their chastity, even if they're extremely poor, Allah promises not just to suffice for their needs and make them live an average life, rather He said, يُغْنِهِمُ اللَّهُ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ, He will make them rich. In Surah Ash-Shura, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَوْ بَسَطَ اللَّهُ الرِّزْقَ لِعِبَادِهِ لَبَغَوْا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَكِنْ يُنَزِّلُ بِقَدَرٍ مَا يَشَاءُ إِنَّهُ بِعِبَادِهِ خَبِيرٌ بَصِيرٌ. If Allah shall amplify the provision for His servants, what will happen? They will revolt on the earth. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends down the provision according to His will, in a way that He knows it suits us most. Why? To protect ourselves against our own greed, our own revolt. Because this is a human nature. When the person has his checkbook and he's ready to write any number, he feels self-sufficient. Versus the person who is like living hand to mouth every day, he says, Ya Rab, Ya Rab, Ya Rab, Ya Rab, he's closer and closer to Allah. It would be excellent if the person can manage to be both, to be rich, extremely rich, giving any charity, assisting the poor. Meanwhile, keeping Allah's rights in perspective, offering the prayer on time, and realizing and recognizing that whatever he has is only from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذْ تَأَذَّنَ رَبُّكُمْ لَئِنْ شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ وَلَئِنْ كَفَرْتُمْ إِنَّ عَذَابِي لَشَدِيدٌ. I want to end up with this. What does it mean? Your Lord has decreed that if you are grateful, if you are thankful, I shall give you more. You want to get richer? It's not only by working harder, rather by saying, thank you Allah, alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah. لَإِنْ شَكَرْتُمْ I shall give you increase. وَلَإِنْ كَفَرْتُمْ If he denied said and made it, oh, it's because of my intelligence, I'm invisible, I'm genius, I'm smart. إِنَّ عَذَابِي لَشَدِيدٌ. According to the CNN report, after the stock market crash, there was a rise in the rate of the millionaires who committed suicide, 25%. Why? Because they were living for the American dream. If the American dream evaporates, then life is not worth living it. Simply, they took their lives. Millionaires killed themselves. And this is the CNN report in that. Why? Because if I cannot live the kind of life I'm living, somebody opens the door for me and I have my own chauffeur and I have this, then I don't deserve to live. This is not the case. In fact, the believer is always grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Musa alayhi salam once said to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Allah, you spoke to me without tabayyun. You blessed me with this and this and this and that. Teach me how to be thankful and grateful to you. He said, Ya Musa, for recognizing my blessings upon you, this is how you thank me. By being aware that everything that we have, everything we possess, everything that we produce is basically a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Well, of course, there is still a lot more to talk about, but I just want to remind myself and you brothers and sisters, because we ran out of time and it's almost Isha time. Life is worth living in the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted us to live. What if we don't? Okay, you are on your own without Allah's help, and you will get nothing more than what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed for you. It is not simply by how much work and effort you put in the world, rather it is by, number one, you have a certain provision you will get. You will not get any extra nor less than that. Do your best and put your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Bottom line, do not earn a penny unlawfully. فَإِنَّمَا عِنَّ اللَّهِ لَا يُطْلَبُ بِمَعْصِيَةٍ. Since the provision is from Allah, you cannot take it from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by disobeying Him. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us plenty of provision, increase our risk, and make us rich and thankful. Make us rich and charitable. make us search and understand these gifts that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has tested us with, as well as He tested the poor with poverty. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. I believe we can spare a few minutes for Q&A.
Zakum wa khairin. Could we ask the volunteers to grab the mic from here and we'll have their question answered from sisters first?
Table charge for the question?
Sorry, table
charge for the question. How do I get rich now?
I have a question.
Put another question.
We'll have your sisters first and then someone.
Yeah.
Do we have a question first from there? Yeah, do we have a question?
Just you see them.
Yeah. If you can't say it, then you can probably write it down and we have a question from brother first then?
No. Go ahead, sister. Go ahead, sister.
Assalamu alaikum, brother. I have a question as to music is considered to be haram in Islam. Please explain it to us why is it considered to be haram. And recently there was a concert held about Sami Yusuf in Doha.
Hold on a second. What's considered to be haram?
Music.
Okay.
Music. Why is it considered to be haram?
Okay.
And secondly, recently there was a concert held about Sami Yusuf. He is a very famous singer. He sings while praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he uses drums, instruments, violins. So listening to this music, is it permissible or not?
Okay. Music is one of the things which, if you read in any felt books, you'll find two conflicting opinions. But the vast majority of the fuqaha and the companions are of the view that it is not permissible to play or listen to any other musical instruments other than the dhaf on the weddings, celebrations, and festivities, and so on. Why? Because a straightforward hadith, which is collected by Imam Bukhari, in which the Prophet ﷺ emphasized that the time will come when people will perceive adultery as, you know, halal, they consider boyfriend and girlfriend. That's adultery, okay? They would consider wearing silk and gold for men as lawful. They would consider drinking as lawful. Wal ma'azif. So the four things were mentioned together, which makes you perceive, according to the divergent meaning, that these things, which the Prophet ﷺ said that the time will come where some people will consider them halal, that means what they are already? Haram. Some of the Mufassirin, such as Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and others, commented on the ayah of Surah Luqman as these are the mazamir of the shaytan and the tools, musical instruments, the tools of the shaytan with which he persuades people to divert them from the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and so on. I normally like to be on the safe side. And I go with the opinion of the vast majority of the fuqaha. This is number one. Number two, those who say it is permissible, the condition that it does not move the sakin, yani it does not incite you, such as a love song, or give me any of those songs which is not something really. Nothing is beneficial, of course. Nothing is beneficial, you know? It's all about Habibi and Habibti, you know? Okay, what about the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ قَطْرُ مَا إِلْمُ الْقُلُوبِ مَنْ تَرْبَتَ تَتَتَتَتَ. This is not dhikr. I attended once in my youth, I wanted to check out these guys and I saw things like this, men and women are dancing together, call it dhikr. Well, they perceive it as dhikr. I said, no way the Prophet ﷺ would do such thing. Whenever the Prophet ﷺ would do dhikr, the companions كَأَنَّ عَلَى وُسِهِمَ الطَّيْرَ, as if there were birds sitting on top of their heads, they wouldn't move. They wouldn't shake and dance on right and left. I can live without it, and as a matter of fact, I live without it, and I live happily pull their eyes. Next, please.
Can I have from the brother there, please?
Assalamu alaikum. On one hand, when we give for Allah's sake, Allah will increase us in our provision. But on the other hand, our risk is already written for us. How do we comprehend this? Like, it seems to be a contradiction, but it isn't. How do we comprehend this?
There is a missing piece of information, otherwise there is no contradiction. I'll tell you the missing piece of information. In one hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, ثَلَاثَةٌ أُقْسِمُ عَلَيْهِمْ. I swear to the efficiency of three things. One of them is, مَا نَقَصَ مَالُ عَبْدٍ مِّن صَدَقَةٍ. He says, I swear to Allah, one's wealth would never decrease due to giving in a charity. Rather, it will increase, definitely. How? I'll tell you the mechanism. There's something called the qadr and the qadr. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed, if this person were to do this, I will bless him with that. If he doesn't, he will be deprived from this, and so on. Okay? So when you please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you fulfill His command, you get what He promised. He will deliver what He promised you. Is it clear? مَا نَقَصَ مَالٌ مِّن صَدَقَةٍ. Definitely one's wealth will not decrease due to giving any charity. Now,
we have a question.
The sisters. Yes. I already upset them with the music question, so bring it up. I hope you're not going to ask about dating. Haram. Haram. Now.
Yeah.
Assalamu alaikum. Please can you briefly describe about the kind of dressing women should have while going out and also in the home in front of their mahrams and women?
That's a good question. I wish we had plenty of time to explain furthermore, but in brief, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Ya ayyuha nabiyyu, قل لأزواجك وبناتك ونساء المؤمنين يدنين عليهن من جلابيبهن ذلك أدنى أن يعرفن فلا يؤذين. Allah is ordering the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to pass on this teaching and this command to his wives, his daughters, and to the Muslim women. To lower down their jalabib, their outfit, so it covers them entirely, and it does not show any of the beauty. يُدْنِينَ عَلَيْهِنَّ مِنْ جَلَابِبِهِنَّ. In order to be recognized as chaste women, any outfit which is loose and does not cause any sort of attraction is a hijab. So in a woman, the requirement in the hijab of a woman, it shouldn't be tied, revealing the details of the body, or otherwise there are some sort of abayas in the market where sisters who wear niqab, they wear it. I believe if they're not wearing niqab at all, it would be much better. As a matter of fact, wearing a pair of jeans, torn pair of jeans, would be better than wearing such abaya. Abaya is very shiny. Normally, this the kind of fabric was used in the past for their sleeve dress, sleepwear. Now they go out with it, full of glitters, shiny, with the curves. It describes the very details of the body. And when extended eye, lashes, you know? Eyelashes, no, eyelashes like whippings from the niqab. This is not hijab. One day, we were in the car and I saw a showcase, and the model, they had dressed the model with one of these abayas and with a calligraphy. You know, I'm an artist, so I like calligraphy a lot, and I taste it a lot. It was divine calligraphy, right on the chest area, you know? And I said, what is this? One of the adhkar. So I got on the car and I went to the shop owner and said, are you crazy? What is this? I said, this is abaya, and this is zikr. I said, I know it is zikr, but it is not proper. It is not power at all. You know, this is all from the shaitan. Shaitan made it seem fair to them. Every woman on earth knows exactly what is she doing when she sits before the mirror for an hour or two, making up herself so that she will look pretty when she leaves. Why did the Prophet ﷺ forbid women from wearing perfume upon leaving home? Why? Because it rings the bell. I read door. And so on. Yeah, I can tell. I told you I was into that. So anyway, if you go by the ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَا يَضْرِبْنَ بِأَرْجُلِهِنَّ لِيُعْلَمَ مَا يُخْفِينَ مِنْ زِينَتِهِنَّ. And let them not stamp their feet in order to show their hidden zina. Stamping the feet because in the past they used to wear anklets. So if the woman would walk, they so everybody would be alert that there's a woman walking here. Nowadays, they don't wear ankles, rather they wear high heels. Is an indication, is ringing the bell, there is a female here, look at me. The sister has to know that the Prophet has said for her, وَلْيَخْرُجْنَ to the masjid تَفِلَاتْ تَفِلَاتْ يَعْنِي very ordinary. No makeup whatsoever. No makeup whatsoever, wearing the proper clothes that it shouldn't be see-through, it shouldn't be tied, revealing the awrah of the body. And just remember one thing, Umar ibn Abdul Aziz radiallahu anhu was very handsome man. He was the fifth Khalifa, as you guys know. So one of the poets came to admire him with a poem, and he started saying, your hair, your eyes, he said, my eyes, you should see them 3 days after the battle. Every one of us should think about themselves after the layah, being alone in the grave. Who's going to look at you? Not even your most beloved. No one can dare to bear the smell. So imagine this life which could end right now. It is not worth challenging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your beauty is only for your husband. Bas. At home, most of the disasters which we see in the Catholic Church in America fall for bankruptcy. Why? Sitting in the cases of child molestation. When the girls sitting before their parents wearing very, very short shorts, tied, revealing their thighs and their awrah, what do you expect? What do you expect? And she's going to the priest to confess her sins. What kind of sins you confess? We're going to make the priest a big time sinner. And this is what happened. So also there is a awrah. I am, as a father, I'm not supposed to sit in a pair of shorts before my children. With my spouse, behind closed doors, the entire body is halal to look at for both parties. But the children before the parents, there is a awrah for a man before every man, and a woman before every woman, such as from the navel to the knees. And it doesn't mean that part is covered and wearing tight clothes as well. No. Tie is like not wearing anything. Maybe it's even more revealing. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, يُبْنِينَ عَلَيْهِنَّ مِنْ جَلَابِي بِهِنَّ ذَلِكَ أَدَنَا أَنْ يُعَرَفْنَا فَلَا يُزَيْنَ. And in Surah Al-Nur in Ayah number 31, he said, وَلَا يُبْنِينَ زِينَتَهُمْ. Anything which you think it's a zina, is glitter. يعني a sister is wearing abaya, and wearing niqab, and the sleeves are open, without cuffs. So she goes to the shop, can you give me, and it rolls down. That is not deliberately. Don't tell me that she doesn't know. So beware of that. We are dealing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Jazakumullah khairan.
One last question, please.
Inshallah.
One question. Can you
answer? Sorry, Sheikh. He's
got the mind. You think he's going to give it to you?
Yeah.
I don't think so. I can give it to you.
Sheikh, can you tell us about the ayah? You saw your ummah bil khairat and al-hakum al-takathur. Al-Hakm al-Takathur also can mean the khirat, which is competing.
No, it's only concerning competition in piling up wealth and the rivalry of this world.
Okay, can
That's why I'm saying, he will keep completing until you visit the grave. Then by the end, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَتُسْأَلُونَ هَوْمَ إِذِنْ عَنِ الْعِينِ ثُمَّ لَتُسْأَلُونَ هَوْمَ إِذِنْ عَنِ الْعِينِ. You will be asked on the day of judgment about the delight. Abdullah ibn Abbas and the Mufassirin say the delight is not the Lamborghini and the, you know, the Hummer. Not only that, إِنَّ فِي الْمَاءِ الْبَارِدِ لَنَعِيمًا. Drinking cool water on a hot day, Allah! This is a na'im, delight. Allah is going to ask you, did you thank me for this gift? So that means we need to be aware of that everything that is given to us is a gift from Allah, we need to pay its due rights and thanks.
What's the difference between competing and yusari'una fi khairat, which is the one which is for the good?
Competing and?
Yes, al-halq wa takathur, competing for the dunya. And another ayah,
which is the other ayah, there are two ayahs, one Surah Ali Imran and one Surah Al-Hadid, which is وَسَارِعُوا إِلَىٰ مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَجَنَّةٍ عَرْضُهَا السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضُ أُعِدَّتْ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ فِي السَّرَّاءِ وَالضَّرَّاءِ وَالْكَاظِمِينَ الْغَيْظَ وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. الله listed the virtuous acts which we should haste and complete in their regards. Then in Surah Al-Hadid, he said, سَابِقُوا إِلَىٰ مَغْفِرَةٍ مَّن رَبِّكُمْ وَجَنَّةٍ the ayah. But this ayah of Surah Al-Takathur, it's pertaining to completion in the dunya.
Because of the time, we'll have this last question, inshallah.
Yes. As-salamu
alaykum.
Alaykum as-salam.
Thank you, first of all, about the lecture.
Barakallah fi, jazakallah khayyan. The first question to remember to thank, jazakallah khayyan. Ahabbaka ladhi ahbabtani fi, barakallah fi.
Jazakallah. Actually, my question is not about dunya anymore.
You mean I made you change your mind?
It's in the place that I want me and you and everyone here going to be there, inshallah.
Yeah, in Jannah.
Okay, are we going to know each other in the Jannah as we know each other here in dunya? And what about the ruh? And thank you very much.
Not only that we're going to know each other. I'll tell you one thing. Why did I come here? Every one of us has to formulate an intention before making any move. Before marriage, before divorce, before business, before going to school. Why did you decide to study pharmacology? Why did you decide to go for chemical engineering? You have to formulate an intention. And your intention shouldn't be low, earthly. Should be very high. Something that you think that you can serve your deen better and humanity at large better. And that you will be rewarded. This meeting, what's your name, brother?
Musa.
I ask your name because this meeting, inshallah, because of this meeting, on the day of judgment, whoever amongst us will make it to heaven will inquire about the rest. So if I'm missing Musa, I say, this guy who attended one day in Doha distinction, where is he? I wanted to see him. So even if you happen to be in a lower grade, you will be upgraded to see your company. Not that they will be downgraded to meet with you. The Quran is full of indications in this regard, just for the sake of time, maybe in another lecture we can talk about it. Al-Jannah is joy and delight. A couple of days ago I was giving a lecture in Dubai. It's called Path to Paradise. You will find many things in this regard in this lecture. It should be uploaded already on the YouTube. It's very interesting. Jazakallah khair. But thank you for asking this question. Yes, we will get to meet in Jannah, recognize each other. And one very important quality about Al-Jannah that when we sit, no one will be seeing the back of any other person. Rather, all of us will be facing each other. How? Well, this is Jannah.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Jazakallah khair.